Hello, and welcome to the advantages of switching to biodiesel. My name is Carl Lissick, the Lake Michigan Consortium, and thank you for joining us on our winter webinar series. The Lake Michigan Consortium consists of Wisconsin Clean Cities, Chicago Area Clean Cities, and South Shore Clean Cities. Our goal is to provide our three-state stakeholders with opportunities, training, and grant opportunities to enhance fleet performances and reduce emissions while working to leverage our strengths to create opportunities. Please watch our websites for upcoming webinars. We have an exciting webinar today with three nationally known biodiesel leaders. First of all, we'll have Mr. Troy Schoen, who is the Senior Manager of the Renewable Energy Group, start things off, followed by Ms. Jennifer Weaver, who is the OEM Market Development Manager for the National Biodiesel Board. And last but not least, Mr. Michael Dimitroff, Manager of the Air Initiatives for the Chicago Park District. All attendees are in listen-only mode, and this webinar will be recorded. And if you have any questions during today's presentation, please raise your hand and we'll take questions at the end of all the speakers' presentation. As you may know, biodiesel has grown into a 2 billion gallon per year industry with 125 plants across the country, supporting more than 64,000 jobs and providing $11 billion in economic impact. Let's get things started with Mr. Troy Schoen of REG. Troy, take it away.
Terrific. Thank you, Carl. One thing I did want to note is that we will have these slides available for you following the webinar. So I have quite a few slides on here, and I'm not going to make it through all of them. Otherwise, I wouldn't give enough time for Jennifer and others to present. So I'm not going to hit on every single slide that's in the presentation, but you will get a copy of this to look at following the webinar, so you'll have a chance to go back to some of those slides. And if you have any questions about anything you see on there, please reach out to me. You'll have my contact information, and you can give me a call or drop me an email. I want to start here today with a brief overview of Renewable Energy Group. We are a publicly traded company, so I have to put the safe harbor statement out there whenever I get started on the presentation. Nothing you're going to hear today is proprietary. It's all public information. Renewable Energy Group has a mission to enable a cleaner world through lower carbon intensity products and services. And we do that through the production of biomass-based diesel, whether that be biodiesel or renewable hydrocarbon diesel. And we have 13 biomass-based diesel plants across the country producing over 500 million gallons of biodiesel annually. When you look at the biodiesel industry domestically, it's somewhere around 2.8, 2.9 billion gallons, and REG being 500 million gallons of that total production, we're a pretty significant player in the overall production of biomass-based diesel. A couple of plants that I want to point out on this slide out of all of them, since we are here with the Great Lakes Consortium, is our plant in Madison, Wisconsin. And this is a 20 million gallon a year nameplate capacity facility. It's actually in DeForest, Wisconsin, which is right outside of Madison. And that started production of biodiesel back in 2007. I believe it was in April of 2007 that plant first got commissioned. REG, I became part of REG in 2016, and really excited to have that be a part of our overall system here at REG, and we have lots of opportunities to sell, biodiesel, B99, B100 biodiesel from that location. And so for fleets and folks in the Wisconsin area, certainly that facility allows very economical biodiesel to be used in the state of Wisconsin. Now, not to ignore my friends in Illinois and Indiana as well, we have two facilities in Illinois. One is in Danville, Illinois, which is just across the border from Indiana. And then we also have a facility in Seneca, Illinois as well. So we have some really good footprint for biodiesel facilities in that Great Lakes region and can help get biodiesel very economically to any fleet or anybody interested in using it in those locations. This is just a map of our overall footprint. The plants we talked about, those are the green boxes on this map. The blue boxes, what those are our terminal locations. So these are locations where we have either diesel fuel, biodiesel, blends of biodiesel and diesel fuel, or heating oil, or a blend of biodiesel and heating oil called bioheat, or renewable diesel as well. So these blue locations, if you were to look at this map, 5 years ago, you would have seen just a handful of terminal locations or assets that REG had. You look at this map today, and this is a pretty significant footprint for the movement of biodiesel and renewable diesel. And REG is going to continue to grow, and if you're going to look at this map 5 years from now, you're going to see even maybe double the amount of blue boxes that you see on here. We definitely have an initiative to try to reach out our terminal footprint to get more locations for biodiesel to be distributed around the country, because we want everywhere, regardless of where you're at, to be able to have access to biodiesel and use it in your fleet. And so one way we felt we can do that is to help grow this terminal footprint that we have, and you can see that represented here on this map. We do have several products that we offer. Our biodiesel and renewable diesel we offer under a brand name called REG 9000. That's a nod to the BQ 9000 accreditation program that we're going to talk about here in a couple of slides. We also do sell straight diesel fuel, and some people kind of scratch their heads and say you're the largest biodiesel producer and your goal is to help improve the environment, so why do you sell straight diesel fuel? Well, we recognize that in order to use biodiesel, you've got to have something to blend it into, and so by having diesel available at terminal locations, we're able to sell biodiesel blends from B2 to B20 or even higher, selling B50 today to somebody in the Midwest. So. Having a diesel position at those locations helps to get blended fuel out there. And then, like I said, we also offer straight heating oil and then the blend of biodiesel and heating oil called BioHeat. And that primarily focus of that is up in the Northeast markets. So that's REG, but what about biodiesel in general? And from a very high level, I'm probably the least technical person, not only on this phone call, but certainly in the building here at REG. But from a very high level, what biodiesel is it takes triglycerides from various fats and oils. It reacts those triglycerides with methanol, and during this process called transesterification, you get two products. You get glycerin and you get methyl esters, and methyl esters is just another name for biodiesel. That's the product that you're wanting to produce, and so that's a very high level of how this process works. Seems pretty simple, and it is. So anybody can produce biodiesel with the right recipe. And in the early days of biodiesel production, you certainly had anybody producing it. You had people producing it in their garages and their bathtubs at home, and putting it in their VW and you know, running around on it. So the industry has changed a lot from those days, and things like BQ accreditation program and ASTM standards and all of these things have been put in place to help make sure that only high quality biodiesel is out there in the marketplace today. And that's where our industry has evolved to today. So while the process at a very high level is pretty simple, those things that have been put in place create an industry which is very technical and highly skilled, and REG is one of those highly skilled producers. The benefits of biodiesel I could really categorize into three areas. It enhances the performance of engines, it improves the environment, and it reduces overall fuel costs. And so if I'm meeting with a fleet for the very first time and I say, hey, if I could offer you a product that does those three things, would you be interested? 100% of the time they say yes. So why then, when you look at the industry and biodiesel itself is less than 5% of the total distillate pool in our country, why is biodiesel not more readily adopted? Because it offers those three advantages, really the three key advantages to any fuel buyer or fuel purchaser in our country. If you could offer those three things, then they'd say, yeah, it's the product that I'm interested in buying. So why is biodiesel less than 5% of the total distillate pool? The answer is, I don't know. I wish it were greater, and it should be greater. And I think we all have opinions on reasons that it's being held back. But one of the ways we can get around that is things like what we're doing here today and webinars where we can bring the Clean Cities consortiums together and bring folks like all of you on the line together to talk about the benefits of biodiesel and break through some of these myths or things that are out there about biodiesel so that it can be more readily adopted into the total distillate pool. So that's what we're doing here today and what we hope to accomplish. One of the other ways we can do that, I believe, is with true facts and information. And it's great to tell somebody that biodiesel improves the environment, but if you don't have some charts or things to actually show people that, sometimes it might not be truly understood. And so this is one of those charts that I like to show. And what you're looking at here is the 0% on this line is straight diesel fuel. And everything above the line is the percent reduction that biodiesel brings in emissions reductions in these three categories. So if you look at total hydrocarbons, for example, a 100% biodiesel is going to reduce total hydrocarbons versus straight number two ULSD by 70%. That's pretty significant. So if you blend that at a B20 level, at a 20% biodiesel level, you get a 10% reduction in total hydrocarbons. Then if you move over to particulate matter, at a B20 blend, you have almost a 20% reduction in particulate matter. And particulate matter is that black soot and smoke that comes out of the back of a tailpipe of a diesel a truck or a diesel bus. And particulate matter can be reduced by almost 20% from using just a B20 blend of biodiesel. That's pretty significant. And when you look at carbon monoxide at a B20 blend, biodiesel reduces that by almost 5%. So you get some very significant emissions benefits from the use of biodiesel just at a 20% blend level. In fact, if you look at total greenhouse gas emissions, and this is just REG data, if you look at total greenhouse gas emissions, we have reduced since 2010 over 3 million metric tons of carbon monoxide since 2010. That's pretty cool, and I'm pretty proud of that, and that's why I share that. We've actually displaced over 1 billion gallons of diesel fuel since 2010. I know one of the goals of the Clean Cities Coalition is to displace petroleum diesel, and just think that REG has done that by over 1 billion gallons since 2010. So it's pretty cool. We've done some pretty cool things in a very short period of time, and we're just one company. So when you look at the total industry, that's a pretty significant reduction in greenhouse gas emissions over time. One of the things in those early days that I talked about, when you had all those folks who were blending biodiesel in their garage and their bathtub, and one of the things that the industry realized, and MVB, and Jennifer's going to talk here in a minute, but one of the things the industry realized is that we have to put some specifications in place to make sure that what's being produced is of high quality. So an ASTM specification was established. The D6751 is the specification for biodiesel, and it requires 20 tests be done on biodiesel. It includes both quality and performance indicators. One thing to note that the specification did not specify specific feedstocks, but it specified the finished fuel. And that's an important component of this. The other important component was the establishment of the need for a certificate of analysis. And if you decide to buy biodiesel and to use that, make sure that with every load, your provider of the biodiesel can provide a certificate of analysis, because that's really important, and all of them should be able to do that. When you look at REG 9000 product specification, so just our specification, you can see how we compare against the ASTM standard. And we meet or exceed the ASTM standard in every category that they have on here, but we actually went even above and beyond the ASTM standard and said, you know what, there's some other things that are important for us to be testing. So we look at things like monoglycerides and diglycerides and the triglyceride content and moisture and density. And we believe that those are important attributes as well. So we actually go above and beyond the ASTM specification in place to do some additional tests on our product to make sure that our REG 9000 biodiesel is the highest quality biodiesel available out in the marketplace. The other important thing that our industry did was put in a BQ9000 accreditation program. And this is a program for producers and marketers. And there's a set of very rigorous quality programs that we have to make sure that we're in place and can be accredited for those and make sure that we aren't having any off-spec biodiesel leave the plant. And so all of our plants are BQ9000 accredited, and it's one of the things that is very important to us. And most of the plants nowadays in the industry, the large refineries of biodiesel are BQ9000 accredited so that we can ensure that the industry is of high quality. REG's product lineup, we offer three products of biodiesel, and we distinguish those based on their cloud point. And so we have an REG 9001, which has a cloud point between -2 to +2 degrees Celsius. Our REG 9005 has a range of 3 to 7 degrees Celsius, and REG 9010 will range from 8 to 12 degrees Celsius. And what that cloud point does is just gives you a range of where this product will will work in what environments. And so if you're in the in a northern climate and you're sitting here in January or February and you're interested in using biodiesel, you may want to use an REG 9001 biodiesel that has a little lower cloud point specification to it. If you're down in Houston, Texas, or someplace in the south, you may want to use an REG 9010, which has a little bit higher cloud point because you don't care as much about the cloud point because your temperature is going to stay well above the 46 degrees Fahrenheit that this product will work in, and so you're going to want to recognize a bit of a savings from using an REG 9010 product versus using an REG 9001 in the wintertime. So choosing which product to use, obviously REG can help you decide what product is right for you according to where you're at in the country, but certainly you can look at this as a parameter for what product you want for your finished specification. The important thing here is that you want to decide what's right for you. So you want to decide what's right for your situation, for your part of the country and what you're comfortable with, and you want to say, and you want to let the producer know that that's my specification for biodiesel that I want to use. And then it's up to the producer to hit that. So REG is feedstock agnostic, which means that we don't use just virgin vegetable oils in the production of our biodiesel. We actually will use animal fats, we'll use cooking oil, we'll certainly use some vegetable oils like soybean and canola oils and in edible corn oils. And we'll use some of these products to hit the finished specification that our customers demand. So we look at that finished specification and we look at all these different triglyceride types that come into our system, and we've perfected the recipe to take all these different feedstocks and still hit that finished specification for what the customer demands. So that's why it's important to keep in mind that don't just call in and say, hey, I'm interested in soy biodiesel, or I'm interested in canola biodiesel, or whatever it is. Instead, call in and say, hey, I'm interested in biodiesel that will hit this parameter or these specifications, and let the producer decide how best to produce that. The advantage that gives to the end user is a couple things. Number one is that you aren't tied into just one specific market for biodiesel. If you specify only soy biodiesel and the soybean oil industry goes up, the cost of soybean oil increases, the cost of your biodiesel is going to increase as well. If you don't specify the feedstock that goes in, but just the finished parameter for that product, and soybean oil goes up, we'll switch to an edible corn oil or use cooking oil to a different product to help alleviate that cost increase to you, the end user of your biodiesel. So that's why it's important to pay more attention to the finished specification than it is the feedstock going in to that biodiesel. As you can see, there's retailers all across the country selling biodiesel. You look at this map 5 years ago, you'd see a lot fewer blue dots. You look at this map 10 years ago, you'd see a handful of dots on here. The industry has really embraced, the fuel industry in general, has really embraced biodiesel, and you've seen the number of retailers offering blends of B10 to B20 increase significantly all across the country, all times of the year. You look at Minnesota, and they have a usage requirement in place for B20 in the summer months, and really anywhere in the country you're seeing folks use biodiesel, and they're doing that for those three reasons that I mentioned earlier: the enhanced performance, the improved environment, and the reduction in fuel costs. If you look at some of the largest travel centers and truck stops who have locations all across the country, they're using B20 about year round because of the financial advantage that they get from doing that. How does that financial advantage recognize? So how do you see it as an end user or as somebody interested in biodiesel? What does that financial advantage look like? Well, there's a couple of things, and really I like to point to three areas that have helped make biodiesel cost competitive anywhere in the country, but certainly there's certain pockets where financially it makes a little bit more sense. But those three areas are the federal incentive, through the renewable fuel standard that was established, and established renewable identification numbers, or RINs. And those RINs have a true economic value to them out in the marketplace, and that helps offset the cost of producing biodiesel. The second thing is the tax credit. And the tax credit was put into place retroactively for 2017, but we don't have it in place looking ahead here in 2018 as we sit here today. That tax credit is very important to help us produce biodiesel in a cost-competitive way versus petroleum diesel. and you look at the petroleum diesel, or you look at the crude oil industry, I mean, all of these industries are incentivized. Most industries that have gotten their start in our U.S. have had some sort of incentive there in place to do that. And just like those industries, the biodiesel industry needs that tax credit as well to help biodiesel be economically viable everywhere in the country so that a fleet anywhere in the country can recognize those benefits of using biodiesel. So that's the second economic driver for biodiesel. And the third is in state incentives. And that's the map that you see here up on your screen now, is that certain states have incentives in place to further enhance the incentive of using biodiesel. So you look at Iowa, that has a significant tax incentive in place. You look at Illinois, who has a 6.25% tax differential in place. You look at the state of Texas for B100, there's a 20 cent per gallon tax savings that you get. So if you blend at a B20 level, you're looking at 4 or 5 cents advantage there. You look at California with their low carbon fuel standard, and Oregon and soon to be Washington. There's significant incentives all across the country in these certain pockets of the country to incentivize the use of biodiesel, and those just help offset the cost and help it reduce the cost of biodiesel even further against petroleum diesel. Here's an example for you, and if we were all live in a room, I'd do this up on a board so you can kind of walk your way through this. And some of these numbers are a bit outdated. I know if you look at the diesel price today, you're closer to $2 a gallon, but for illustrative purposes, at this particular time, if you looked at the cost of number two ULSD, and it was $1.65 a gallon, if you were to go to REG plant, so let's say REG Madison in Madison, Wisconsin, and pick up a B99 biodiesel from our plant at the same time, you would have paid $2.95. So are you, fleet manager, fuel purchaser, going to buy biodiesel for $2.95 if you can buy diesel fuel for $1.65? Heck no. You aren't going to do it. You're going to lose your job if you do that, right? I don't care how much you care about the environment or how much you care about enhancing the performance of your engine. You aren't going to do it for that price. You're going to spend $1.30 more a gallon to buy biodiesel. You'd lose your job if you did that. So we need these other incentives that are in place to help offset some of that cost of production of biodiesel and the cost of the feedstock. And one of the things that does that, as I mentioned, was the renewable fuel standard, which established the renewable identification numbers. So for easy math here, I put RIN value at $1. Today it's somewhere in the low 80 cents range. But for this illustrative purpose, I put it at $1. And biodiesel qualifies for 1.5 D4 RIN. So you take that dollar worth of value, you multiply that by 1.5, and you have $1.50 worth of value that the RIN creates. And you just simply subtract that off the price to actually produce the biodiesel, the $2.95. And so if you actually go into REG Madison to pick up biodiesel, in this illustrative example, you'd be paying $1.45 a gallon versus going to the rack and picking up diesel fuel for $1.65. So you would recognize a 20 cent per gallon savings by using biodiesel. And this illustrative example, while the numbers may be a little bit different today, diesel prices would be closer to $2. REG plant price would be closer to the low $3 range. That difference, or that disparity between the price of diesel fuel and the price of biodiesel still remains. And that will continue to remain as long as the RFS stays in place. So you recognize savings using biodiesel. Now, that savings can be offset if you're a significant distance away from a biodiesel plant, because freight can eat that cost up a bit. But if you're within the range of the Great Lakes region, and I talked about our three plants that we have within that region, you're within range of being able to have a biodiesel at a cheaper price than diesel fuel. And so there's no reason to pay more for biodiesel, certainly in that location and many locations around the country. And then the other component to throw on top of this is those state incentives that I talked about. And so if you're getting a 6.25% tax savings like you are in the state of Illinois on top of these economics, that just makes even more sense to use biodiesel and start including that in your fuel lineup. So one question I get asked before I jump into my concluding slides here and turn it over to Jennifer is that, well, that's great that I can save all this money using biodiesel, but what am I going to lose out on fuel efficiency? And I'd argue that that argument, you know, you hear that more on the ethanol side than you do the really the biodiesel side. There hasn't been a lot of significant work that's been done, but there have been 4 published studies that have shown that there's no statistical significant difference in fuel efficiency between a B0 and a B20. And I can get you more information on those 4 studies if you're curious in digging in the, into those a little bit more. But the reality is that biodiesel up to a B20 blend, you aren't going to lose out on the fuel efficiency. You're going to reduce the number of regens that you have in your engine. You're going to get benefits that such as the lubricity that then the higher cetane, which actually help with efficiency. And so you aren't going to have a reduction in fuel efficiency when you use biodiesel. So there's really no disadvantage economically. In fact, there's a significant advantage economically to using biodiesel in your fuel lineup. So let me conclude with maybe you're online right now and you're managing a fleet or a municipality and you're a fuel buyer and you say, well, this sounds great, Troy. I'm interested in potentially, you know, using biodiesel and putting it into my fleet. How do I go about doing that? So let me give you 5 steps to leave with here on how you can successfully integrate biodiesel into your vehicle lineup. First is you want to consider your comfort level with blending. So you have to make a decision whether you want to do the biodiesel blending yourself or whether you just want to go to a distributor or go to the rack and buy it. Certainly your greatest economic advantage or the lowest fuel cost overall is for you to do the blending yourself. For you to go and work with a company like REG and buy B99 biodiesel direct from one of our plants and have it delivered to a tank where you have the biodiesel and then you also have the diesel fuel tank and you do the blending yourself. That's where you're going to recognize that 20 cent worth of savings. That's where you're going to recognize the greatest savings per gallon. However, there is a bit of an upfront cost if you don't already have a tank available to use biodiesel. So the second option is to go to a distributor and ask your distributor if they carry biodiesel. In all instances, those distributors, you know, hopefully those distributors carry biodiesel, and if they don't, you need to find a distributor who does. Step 2 of integrating biodiesel into your fuel lineup is to confirm the quality of your biodiesel supply. So if you have decided that yes, I want to start using biodiesel, and either you want to buy B99 or you're buying a blended fuel from a distributor from the rack, still make sure that the quality of that biodiesel is sound. So make sure that it meets the ASTM D6751 standards. Make sure it's coming from a BQ9000 accredited producer. Make sure that that producer can provide a certificate of analysis with each load. If they can't, then you shouldn't buy from them because they should be able to do that. And work with a producer that can provide additional technical support, who has a team of lab people who can take your fuel samples and do the testing that you want to do with it. Step 3 is to determine the blend level that you want to use. I recommend if you're hesitant about using biodiesel for whatever reason, start with a B2 or 2% blend level and move up from there. I'm pretty confident that you'll move up pretty quickly because you'll like that the advantages that biodiesel gives you. But decide at what blend level you want to use. Certainly if you're in January and you see a cold front coming through, you probably don't want to start out right at a B20. You probably want to start at something a little bit lower and work your way up from there. Step 4 is to educate your employees. So talk to your employees about the benefits of biodiesel and why you're wanting to use more biodiesel and putting it as part of your fuel lineup. Make sure that they're educated on the advantages of biodiesel because they're pretty significant and they'll want to feel good about using biodiesel. And then step 5, the final one, is just to reap the benefits of it. Reap those benefits of reduced emissions, of the increased engine performance, of the better fuel cost to you, and just recognize that biodiesel has some pretty significant benefits to you, and at the end of the day can do those 3 things: enhance performance, improve the environment, and reduce fuel costs. So I think I'll conclude there, and this presentation has some case studies here at the end I'll let you spend some time with on your own, and it shows some examples of fleets that have integrated biodiesel successfully into their fuel program and have reaped the rewards of doing that, and so I'll let you spend some time with those. But at this time I'll be done and turn it over to Jennifer. I think we're taking questions here at the end if you have any.
That's correct, Troy. Thank you very much for that presentation, Ms. Jennifer Weaver, who is the OEM Market Development Manager for the National Biodiesel Board. is with us now. Jennifer?
Thank you very much, and thanks for the opportunity to join you today. As I mentioned earlier, I am serving as the OEM Market Development Manager for the National Biodiesel Board. In that role, I'm essentially kind of a liaison between the auto and equipment manufacturers and the biodiesel industry, and working with them to foster their continued support and growth and support of the use of biodiesel blends in their current and future diesel vehicle models. So I'd like to start off my comments today with a question that seems to be kind of top of mind in the media and in the marketplace today, and that is, how will diesel most likely be changed in the future? You know, there are always a slew of new technologies being discussed in the marketplace and in the media, like I said. Electrification is all the buzz nowadays. So what does the road ahead look like? And really, in order to answer that question, we really need to consider both the fuels market as well as the vehicle market. They really work hand in hand and are inseparable. And as the automakers are seeking to comply with ever-increasing and increasingly stringent requirements for their vehicle performance in terms of fuel efficiency and cleanliness, those requirements are impacting their future product planning efforts, as well as the fuel choices that go into those vehicles. So we're going to spend a little time talking about that today. The good news is, despite all of the talk about electrification, especially when we look at the commercial vehicle market where most fleets are operating, those vehicles are going to continue to be depending upon your traditional combustion engines, both diesel and gasoline powertrain engines, for quite a while to come. So recently, the Fuels Institute last year instituted commissioned a study through Navigant Research, looking closely at future projections for the medium and heavy duty vehicle fleet through 2025 was their forecast period they were looking at. And you can kind of see here by these charts, the big yellow bar here represents the share of the market that diesel powertrains are going to continue to dominate through 2025, again, the forecast period. This tiny little black strip that you see up here are the other powertrains, and gasoline still has a large share as well. So this first block is the U.S. market. The bottom block there is the Canadian market share, where diesel powertrains are even more omnipresent. Now let's take a look at that in a little bit more detail. I'm going to here just to make sure you can all hear me correctly. If we look a little bit in more detail here, we can see that even through the forecast of 2025, diesel is dominating about 62% of powertrains in the commercial vehicles. They lose a little bit of share perhaps over the time, but it's being actually brought up then by hybrid electric diesel and plug-in hybrid electric diesel. So again, we're going to continue to see diesel powertrains in the marketplace for quite some time. Now the good news for biodiesel is, what if there is a way to operate all of those diesel vehicles in a cleaner and more sustainable way without sacrificing the performance that fleets demand? As you can see by this rather extreme picture here, we asked a lot of our diesel vehicles. They need to tow, they need to have great fuel economy. Biodiesel can solve that problem for them. Biodiesel blends up to B20 and in some cases higher blends can be used in existing or legacy equipment as well as the new technology diesel engines without modification. And B20 is supported by over 90% of the OEMs in the marketplace. When we take a look at the variables or the decision points that consumers and fleets are considering when they are looking at new vehicle purchases, they're looking at a variety of things. And those tables that I showed you before factored in all of those elements in making their forecasts. So first, they're looking at technology costs. What is the purchase price of this particular vehicle compared to maybe your typical options? Energy costs, what's it going to cost per gallon to fuel this vehicle up, and what kind of fuel efficiency will you get? Vehicle compatibility, what kind of range and power, hauling and towing power is it going to have again, is it going to do the work that they demand of their diesel vehicle fleet presently? Accessible infrastructure, we're talking about refueling or recharging opportunities. How easy is that to come by, and how available is that in the marketplace that you work within? Geopolitical concerns are things like, you know, how does this particular technology help us with reducing oil consumption or imports of foreign oil? Environmental concerns, Troy touched on this a bit, you know, how will this fuel or this vehicle help us to reduce carbon and greenhouse gases? Maintenance, the cost of the vehicle upkeep itself, and how does that compare with what we've been experiencing? And finally, automaker support. Are the automakers supporting this technology both in their current and future vehicles and working it in with their research and development efforts? So the great news for biodiesel is that it makes the grade on all of these fronts. Troy's talked to you about a few of them, and I'll go into a little bit more detail as well. But really, it makes a whole lot of sense for fleets, because biodiesel really is one of the least cost options to green your fleet operations. So the question is, they can do it. Are they doing it? Are fleets actually implementing biodiesel programs? And the answer is yes, to a growing extent. And like Troy said, we'd always like to see more of them. But another organization that the National Biodiesel Board works closely with is the NTEA, which is the Association for the Work Truck Industry. Every year they put out a fleet purchasing outlook survey to their members, which are largely fleets and equipment manufacturers. As of 2017 survey, biodiesel, CNG, and E85 were the most widespread alternative fuel preferences for that year. So about 15% of fleets are currently using biodiesel blends in their operations. They also ask, so looking ahead, what are your future fuel and vehicle purchase plans? And again, biodiesel, CNG, and E85 were at the top of the heap there. Electrics, for all of their hype in the light-duty market, are still having a harder time making penetration in the medium and heavy-duty markets, simply because of the long range and heavy towing requirements that those markets serve or require. Troy mentioned some case studies, which I definitely do encourage you to take a look at the end of his presentation. Here's just a snapshot of some of the notable biodiesel fleet users, just a few among many, and you're going to get to hear more from one of them here at the end of this session as well, so I won't steal his thunder, but a lot of, you know, very major fleets across many different types of industries and applications using biodiesel very successfully in their operations. So why are these fleets using biodiesel? And let's take a little bit of another look at that. Troy mentioned some of the economic advantages as well as some of the performance advantages. Just kind of looking at a big picture perspective. Biodiesel is providing a very high quality fuel from domestic, sustainable, renewable resources. Again, enhancing our energy security and allowing us to reduce the imports of foreign oil from parts of the world that may not always be stable or friendly toward the U.S. Biodiesel also is doing great things for our domestic economy. It's supporting over 64,000 U.S. jobs and generating over $11 billion dollars in total economic impact for the U.S. Again, great contributions to our gross domestic product here. As Troy mentioned earlier, biodiesel is doing great things for the environment as well in terms of reducing particulates, carbon monoxide, unburned hydrocarbons. That was especially notable and is especially notable in the older engines, those prior to, say, 2010 when new after-treatment systems were implemented. But also works exceedingly well in the new technology diesel engine. You know, we've talked somewhat about reducing greenhouse gas emissions, and biodiesel really does have the best carbon footprint of any U.S. produced fuel. So let's just take a quick look at that, what we mean by that. We consider biodiesel carbon from a life cycle carbon perspective. So as the plant materials that are oftentimes used to produce biodiesel are growing, they are actually absorbing CO2 from the atmosphere, from the air. And when you consider the process all the way from, you know, growing those plants or crops in the field to the production of biodiesel to its actual end use in a vehicle, biodiesel on average provides an 80% reduction in carbon emissions compared to petroleum diesel. Also in 2017, there was some new research that concluded that biodiesel reduces greenhouse gas emissions by 72% and fossil fuel use by 80% compared to petroleum diesel. So again, a lot of great environmental benefits associated with the use of biodiesel blends. Another kind of factor that is heavily on the minds of OEMs is a looming heavy-duty truck standard rule that's being implemented by the EPA. So EPA is proposing to increase the efficiency in heavy-duty transportation significantly, you can see here, by 2027. The end result that's desired from that is a cumulative greenhouse gas savings of over 1 billion tons of CO2. So it's going to be a pretty heavy lift for the OEMs to get to that point in terms of technology. So they are looking ever more closely at biodiesel as an enabling technology, if you will, to help them get there. So this kind of shows you how that trajectory could happen. So if you look here, the green bars kind of indicate the impact that the newly designed trucks, heavy duty vehicles would be contributing to those emissions reductions. Those kick in 2021. Biodiesel has been making improvements for our atmosphere since the early 2000s. And when you compile those benefits of biodiesel on top of the heavy-duty truck rule, you see that we can make a much bigger dent in the CO2 emissions by using high-quality biodiesel blends in today's new technology diesel engine. And it's working. As Troy mentioned, you know, he kind of showed you the snapshot of even just one company's production and use of biodiesel blends. When we look at it from a macro perspective, the 2.9 billion gallons of biodiesel and renewable diesel that were used in 2016 reduced carbon emissions by over 24 million metric tons. If you think about that in kind of real world terms that we could all relate to, that's similar to removing over 5 million cars from our roadways, or planting 641 million trees, or preserving over 23 million acres of forest. So all of those things are making a significant impact in the marketplace. And another great benefit of biodiesel is its sustainability. Oftentimes there's a lot of confusion on a food and fuel kind of debate in the marketplace. And biodiesel is really a success story in that regard, because with biodiesel, food isn't sacrificed for fuel. In fact, making more biodiesel helps make more food available and vice versa. So the oils and fats that are used for biodiesel production are a minor byproduct of producing food for humans and animals. About 50% of the biodiesel that's currently produced and used in the United States is made from soybean oil. Soybeans are about 80% protein and 20% oil. So that 80% protein content is going into food and feed for humans and animals. We use a fraction of that oil content then to make a very high quality biodiesel. Likewise, no one's growing more livestock for its fat content. As meat production continues, we can use the byproducts, the fats from that meat processing process to be able to make biodiesel. Likewise, no one's cooking more French fries to get used oil. We're just able to use that waste product, the used cooking oil, again, to make a very high quality biodiesel product. So it's kind of the great recycler, if you will, making a great fuel out of something that otherwise would have gone into the waste stream. I'm gonna kind of round out my comments here talking about OEM support for biodiesel. This is really where the rubber meets the road, if you will, in terms of, so we have this great fuel, our OEM's gonna allow me to use it in my vehicles? The answer is absolutely yes. All major OEMs producing diesel vehicles for the US market support at least B5 biodiesel blends. That's pretty much ubiquitous across the industry. And if we're looking specifically kind of in the fleet or commercial vehicle class with gross vehicle weight 5 through 8 vehicles, those account for about 92% of the on-road diesel fuel use presently. and nearly 90% of those medium and heavy duty truck OEMs support the use of B20. So the vast majority of the equipment that's already in your fleet can use B20, or at the very least B5. Likewise, nearly every major off-road equipment manufacturer supports B20 or higher biodiesel blends. So when you're looking at agricultural or construction equipment or groundskeeping equipment, mining, that sort of thing, also they're at a B20 approval level. We do work hard to keep a very comprehensive listing of OEM position statements on the National Biodiesel Board website. So I encourage you to check out biodiesel.org under Using Biodiesel and the OEM Information tab to get some more specific information on the OEM's positions there. We also partner closely with the Diesel Technology Forum and work with them to keep a running list of diesel vehicles available in the U.S. So I encourage you to check out their website as well for information on the current models available for you. But here is a little sneak preview of many of those position statements and vehicles. This is a couple slides of just quick snapshots of the many OEMs that are supporting B20. You can see kind of the Detroit Big Three, GM, Chrysler, Ford, mainstays in the medium duty truck market, you know, Isuzu, et cetera, the ag and off-road market with Caterpillar, Case, New Holland, John Deere. Cummins engines are kind of omnipresent both in on and off-road equipment. And so, you know, that by nature has a lot of different OEMs supporting B20. In many cases, an OEM's position on biodiesel will follow suit with whatever their engine manufacturer, the supplier of their engine, approves. So in the case of, for instance, Freightliner and Western Star, their models that are equipped with Cummins engines are approved for B20. They do have some models that are equipped with Detroit diesel engines, and that is one of the lone holdouts in a B5 position. So we are still working very closely with Daimler, which owns Detroit diesel, to move that position up to B20. Very notably, though, back in 2016, we had been working with PACCAR, which is the engine manufacturer that supplies engines to Peterbilt and Kenworth. And they, back in 2016, announced their full retroactive approval for B20 in all of their legacy and new model diesel engines. So now the entire fleet of Kenworth and Peterbilt trucks with PACCAR engines are approved for B20. That added about a million vehicles worth of B20 approved vehicles onto the roadways. So that was great news. General Motors is another great champion in the biodiesel support arena. They offer 20 different diesel models, all approved for use with B20. Ford, also a longtime supporter of biodiesel, supporting B20 in all of their super duty and medium duty trucks. And very exciting news for you F-150 fans, they're coming out with a diesel F-150 in 2018 and just announced that it too is B20 approved. And as I mentioned, Fiat Chrysler's offerings in the pickup truck, van, and SUV categories also B20 approved. So just as a wrap up here, we are seeing a site for a promising year for biodiesel ahead for OEMs and for fleets as well. We continued on a strong path with over 2.6 billion gallons of biomass-based diesel produced in U.S. Last year, and that was even in a marketplace with a lapsed tax incentive. As Troy mentioned just a couple weeks ago, that biodiesel blenders tax credit was retroactively reinstated for 2017, and the biodiesel industry is continuing to push to install that credit for 2018 and future years to breed more certainty into the marketplace. We do have renewable fuel standard volumes in place for 2018. Biodiesel qualifies under both the biomass-based diesel and advanced biofuel categories. So again, you know, strong marketplace indicators there, and we are excited to see those growing number of diesel vehicle options for 2018. So as we continue to work with OEMs to support that fuel in those vehicles and with fleets to use it, we see a very bright future ahead. I'll let you take a look at these resources available to you again after the call. Highly encourage you to check out these websites that have a vast array of resources for further information, and my contact information is included there as well, and certainly invite your questions or conversation at any time. So thanks so much for your time and attention today.
Thank you, Jennifer. A lot of great information from our first two speakers, and we're just excited about all the great things that are going on across this great country. So our next speaker is Mr. Michael Dimitroff. He's the manager of air initiatives for the Chicago Park District. Welcome, Michael.
And Troy, thank you. I'm here to, serve as an example of all the great information you just heard about biodiesel. I'm with the Chicago Park District, and Carl introduced me as manager of air initiatives. That's apropos, but I'm actually manager of art initiatives. I started in sustainability, and I didn't want to let it go, and that's how this program came about. So I'll move ahead and just talk about some of the things that we do at the park in terms of sustainability efforts. If I get the right slide up here. Sorry. So a park district is involved. Of course, you think about programming, recreation, lake activities. The park has 26 miles of lakefront. So the park wants to also serve as a leader in sustainability and environmental efforts. To that end, we have a renewable fuel fleet. We have a lumber reuse agreement with recycling our emerald ash borer ash. We have wind power supply for our power source, which is now sourced at 75% of wind and alternative energy. We practice LEED certified buildings, car sharing, bike sharing, clean marinas program to certify marinas as sustainable, and we are really conscious on waste and recycling practices. So with this initiative, our biodiesel program started back in 2010. Here's a composition of the park district vehicle fleet, 550 overall, and you can see the breakdown of E85 hybrids, natural gas, and diesel. In 2010, the park district had the opportunity to take over a defunct City of Chicago fueling facility. The city decided it was too small for its uses since it only housed two tanks, 6,000 gallons each. The park district decided to make an investment and push into the biodiesel as sort of a pilot program, which has now become an exemplifier of a good practice. We took over the tanks, converted the facility with a dispenser that mixes at the dispenser, and we set up an agreement with a great partner in Darling Ingredients. Darling agreed to provide feedstock for us, which was yellow grease feedstock. Here's a picture of the facility. The park was interested in this because it's really a carbon neutral feedstock. It's already been served to fuel French fries and fryers throughout the city. So it's recycled vegetable oil grease for food. We take that through Darling, and then we found out that we could send that to a processor and have that converted into usable B99. And bring that back to us at no cost. Since we had this whole agreement started with a donation of the feedstock, we used the feedstock as a credit source and served that to process and also transport biodiesel back to us where we mixed it at this facility for our fleet. We fuel diesel trucks, cab overs, forestry units, clam units, bucket trucks, beachcombers, and our cutting mowers, John Deere cutting mowers. Now, this facility only serves about a third of the lakefront area, so technically it's a pilot. All of our drivers that drive diesel vehicles can fuel here as convenience, but we're focusing on this area exclusively, that everyone comes to this facility fuels with B20. One of the things that when we started the program that we had to be very concerned about is how do we initiate that? I think that's come up a couple times. Where do you start? What's your comfort level? Well, I was not a fleet member, and our fleet director was very cautious about cold flow and cloud point and park district vehicles and plows breaking down in low temperatures. So that was a really big area of concern. We decided to talk to the fleet our fleet partners at the City of Chicago. In fact, you'll see that the fueling track system we're on is still is on City of Chicago fleet. And so it's being monitored by fleet. And so we wanted to roll out in such a way that there wouldn't be a problem. We had a lot of older vehicles. And so with the lubricity and the breakdown, a lot of times the fuel lines get cleaned, you lose the varnish in the fuel, it could clog filters. We wanted to make sure that there wasn't any increase in maintenance cost, and we wanted to document all that. So we started out very slow. We started out with a B5, and then we had orientation sessions with all of our landscape folks who were going to fuel. So we did a combination of starting slow, communication with fleet, and communicating with practitioners and fueling practices. And then we gradually ramped up. So we started with a B10 for a period, and then we ramped up to a B20. And you'll see, sorry about the slide, I can't get the order here. It's not there. Anyway, we started low and worked our way up. What we found is that in the summertime, of course, you can ramp up to B20. The City of Chicago was on a ration for fuel reduction costs, so they only use a certain amount of biodiesel through the summer. One of our goals with the Park District was to demonstrate that we have zero maintenance issues, that we had increased efficiency, lower particulates with no maintenance problems, and then we were trying to pitch the City of Chicago to incorporate a higher use of biodiesel. So I guess one of the things to consider when you're implementing is what's been mentioned by Troy and Jennifer is fuel supply, quality, maintenance, how to train drivers, and how to track data to show your advantages. We've done all that. We've got a partnership through the Darling Ingredient donation with REG, who processes our fuel, like Troy and company. They come back with the BQ9000. We mix at our dispenser at 39th Street. And so we can micro adjust for weather conditions as well. So we generally have one tank that has straight diesel in it, and the other one is B99. And so we can blend on demand at the tank. And that solves some of the issues with concerns for temperature that are going too low, or you got some conditions that you want to modify. We've gone over vehicle compatibility with both presentations. We have John Deere mowing units and some Toro and Kubota. We are using V20 plus in all of those and without any problems. In fact, John Deere, we've pushed up to, I don't think the slide is in here, but we've gone up to B55 last summer without issue. And the good thing about that is that our average biodiesel blend is a B20. We've been asked to join the Illinois B20 club, which is under the guidance of the American Lung Association. So we are improving what we feel is our quality of health and environment in Chicago. Our biggest health affliction with young people in the city is asthma. We've got testimonials from our drivers of our mowing units that there are no longer any particulate matter coming out of the tailpipe. They don't think about their job as much. They don't feel that they're breathing anything, and they feel the benefits directly in what we're doing. We talked a little bit about solvency and how the fuels affect, biodiesel affects the fuel systems. For those of you who are just starting out, again, you start out slow. Here's some of the reasons that happens when biodiesel gets put in and has its detergent quality. So it will kick out some of the impurities in the trucks and the fuel lines, in the tanks, excuse me. You may want to start with new filters, start out slow, monitor things, and keep that data as you go. I'll zip through these a little bit. The big difference with biodiesel usage is in the valves and the synthetic rubbers that were used in the older models. So VTON is a is a brand name of rubber lines and seals that now is acceptable V20 and beyond. So you can pretty much figure if you can, if you're spec for V20, you can figure at some point you can probably push to B99 because it won't affect the seals any further once you get past B20. Fuel storage, if you have tanks, you want to make sure that, you know, there are some dividing lines between fuels at the interface so you get algae, you've got buildups of microbes. But the thing to remember is that it's good to monitor the systems and have a good service provider that knows the best way to treat the fuel. So we have a good provider with the Park District who's been with us since the onset of the program. We send out our fuels to get checked for oxidation and all of the impurities that may be in there. So it's that monitoring by a third party is also very helpful. We send the fuels out to an impartial tester to figure out what exactly we have in the tank. When we get our fuel back from REG, there's always specifications listed, as Troy mentioned. So the quality is never a problem. It's always good to check for contamination and microbes and things that may be occurring in the fuel. But those are standard practices with your fueling stations. Aged fuel, there's been some concern that biodiesel over let sit in a tank for a while is going to lose and lose its purity and combustibility. That's been proven this year by Steve Howe, a chemist who works with the National Biodiesel Board, that you can pretty much have biodiesel sit for a year and not affect its conditions. We had some concern with the city, but they have backup generators that have, they were asking whether or not they should use biodiesel fuel in those. And the suggestion was, yes, go ahead, but monitor it and appropriately treat the fuel. We set up a visual read at our 39th Street facility. You see different biodiesel blends marked out in little vials, and so that at any point in time we can actually do a visual check of what the temperature is and what the cloud point's looking at on top of the tank. So this is just a simple way of for us to double check and to show drivers the difference in fuel. So you see full diesel on the left, B5, B10, B15, and the cloudiness as it goes across. You can't read the thermometer, I think, but it's at about 10 or 15 degrees. Cold weather is also was always the biggest threat or supposed threat with biodiesel for municipalities. And we set out to disprove that because our main goal was to show those at large in the city that we could dispel that myth with proper additives and proper monitoring and blending. We've done that. We, like I said, we're now run on B20 blends year round. We've exceeded to well over 50% of biodiesel in the summer. We are keeping that data, and actually California has asked for our data so that they can utilize that, because the wall was B20. Everyone was looking at data up to B20. But since we've exceeded that, and not many fleets have exceeded, they're asking for data just to demonstrate, you know, efficiency, product use, and what type of returns for fuel efficiency we have with that data. Excuse me. Troy and Jennifer both gone over the attributes of biodiesel, and you can see that for us in the state, we have the tax incentive. So at B11 or above, you don't have to pay for the tax on the fuel. Of course, the Park District is tax exempt. It doesn't affect us. But for me, every gallon of diesel saves, displants a gallon of straight diesel fuel. So for our program purposes, we're saving a lot more money because we're not paying for the fuel at the beginning, since it's a more of a barter process. You can see that we're acting as leaders, and that was our plan. The benefits are, like everyone has mentioned, increased particulates, decreased carbon monoxide, NOx emissions, increased environment, cleaner air, and that's been our mission. That's pretty much it. I just wanted to say that for us, from pilot to now operating at a B20 level, has been a very smooth run. It's doable. You plan it out, you communicate with your fleet team, you roll it out gently, and you just keep pushing from there, and the benefits you'll reap. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Michael. Very interesting. As you were typing in your questions to ask the panel, we do have a couple of questions I'd like to read off. And the first one is for Mike. And the question is, with the park district's success rate of use of biodiesel, are other departments in the city of Chicago looking at implementing forms of biodiesel? Michael?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, now I can.
Okay, sorry. Great question. So we convened a meeting with our fuel provider, my service provider, the B20 Club, and a chemist to show the city of Chicago exactly what we've done over the last 4 years and pitch them into how, as you know, the second city, that we need to up our game in terms of biodiesel. The good news is we opened their eyes and they are now operating on permanent B10 with the hopes of elevating to B20 over the summer months.
Wonderful. I think this question relates to Troy or Jennifer. The question is, are there any special labeling requirements on retail pumps for the use of biodiesel?
I can address that. So can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. So biodiesel blends up to 5% or B5 do not need to be labeled. They are considered just fungible with diesel fuel and meet the same ASTM specs as diesel fuel, which is ASTM B975. So you can and most likely are using a B5 blend just interchangeably with diesel fuel pretty much everywhere now. Above a B5 blend, there is a separate label, typically kind of a light blue and black label that will say this contains a blend of between 6 and 20% biodiesel, a B6 to B20. That kind of range allows retailers some flexibility in terms of maybe seasonal changes in the blend that they're offering. You know, if maybe they're using or pumping a B20 blend in the summer months and might back down to a B5 or B6 in the colder months. So that allows them some flexibility there. Anything above a B20 blend needs to be specifically labeled with the actual blend percentage. So if it's offering a B30, it needs to be marked specifically B30. So those are typically the types of nomenclature that you would see on pumps. And in Chicago, for instance, Mike mentioned, because they have a tax incentive or, you know, remove the sales tax from any gallon containing more than B10, they pump an awful lot of B11 in the state of Illinois. And so I think it's close to going on 60% of the diesel fuel in Illinois actually contains B11, at least up to B20, close to year round.
Thank you for that, Jennifer. This next question, I think it's for Troy. And Troy, one of the questions is, are local bio-based products used in local biodiesel plants to reduce transportation miles and costs? And then the second question would be, are the bio components local to the market or do they come from elsewhere?
Thanks for that question. I think they're talking about, I think the question relates to like the feedstock used to produce the biodiesel and if that's coming locally. And it depends, I guess, is the short answer. But certainly we always look for the reduction in transportation costs. So we're trying to match the closest feedstock sources to the biodiesel plant to reduce that cost. Because once you start shipping stuff greater distances, then your feedstock cost is going to go up. So we always try to match those. We aren't going to take a feedstock from, you know, Texas necessarily and you know, bring it up to the Midwest when it could be used, if it could be used in a plant that we have down in Texas. We're going to try to, you know, keep it in the markets and make the most sense to reduce those costs.
Great. Well, thank you for that. I don't see any more questions on our website, so I just wanted to, again, thank you to our speakers, and then thanks again for joining us on behalf of the Lake Michigan Consortium. We look forward to seeing everyone at our upcoming Lake Michigan Consortium Green Drives event on Thursday, May 17th at the Northern Illinois University in Naperville. And please see any of our websites for additional information. And remember, it's never too late to begin your environmental legacy. Thanks for joining us today, folks.